Welcome to the Embrace Forum series. This series has been designed to connect you with Dana-Farber's team of experts so that you can learn more about the treatment, research, and care of metastatic breast cancer. My name is Catherine Rigby, and I am the Embrace Program Manager at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. During today's event, Dr. Sarah Sammons will address how we monitor if treatment is working in metastatic breast cancer and the concepts of staging scans, progression, and when it may be time to change therapies. Then, we're going to hear from Dana-Farber's clinical social worker, Jessica Mosey, as she shares strategies for managing the Scanxiety that often occurs between scans. Afterwards, there will be a Q&A session with both Dr. Sammons and Jessica. But for right now, I would like to bring your attention to two very important buttons on the bottom of your screen, the chat button and the Q&A button. To communicate with other people on the call and our presenters, please use the chat button. You're welcome to introduce yourself and say hello. And then throughout the event, as you think of questions for the Q&A, please be sure to use the Q&A button on the bottom of your screen. You can either include your name or keep it anonymous. But please be aware that questions entered into the chat are likely to be missed during the Q&A, so please be sure to use the Q&A button. Now, it is my great honor to introduce you to Dr. Sarah Sammons. Dr. Sammons is a medical oncologist at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. She is the Associate Director of Embrace, which is the Metastatic Breast Cancer Program, and a faculty member of Harvard Medical School. Her clinical focus is on the treatment of all metastatic breast cancer subtypes and patients facing brain metastases. Welcome, Dr. Sammons. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you so much for having me and everyone who is joining this session. Thank you for joining. We put a lot of thought into what educational webinars that we want to put out. And we have heard a lot from patients, and I certainly hear a lot from my patients, questions regarding the treatment and how we monitor progression and staging in patients with metastatic breast cancer. But also, very importantly, how distressing those monitoring mechanisms can be. And so we're going to address all of that today. And please feel free to answer or ask any questions in the Q&A. Next slide. So first, let's start out with the goals of treatment of metastatic breast cancer. You've been diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer. Your doctor or your treatment team says, let's get you started on a treatment. The treatment is generally based on the type of breast cancer that you have, the subtype, the estrogen status, the progesterone status, the HER2 status. Maybe it's based on some biomarkers. You get started on a treatment. What's next? How do we monitor your MBC? How do we make sure that the treatment's working? And we're going to address some of that today. So you're started on a systemic therapy. The goal of therapy is to control the MBC for as long as possible so that we don't see new areas or growth of other areas that we've identified on the scans. Our goals of treatment are also to improve any symptoms of the metastatic breast cancer lesions that you might have. And of course, also to prolong life for as long as we can. And generally, you know, when I meet a new patient with MBC, I say we start a treatment, try it until it's not working anymore. But in general, therapy continues indefinitely. And that's a very, very tough pill for patients to swallow. But we do continue treatment until a patient doesn't want to continue treatment anymore or until, you know, we run out of therapies that we think would be effective. Next slide. So we start the initial treatment. This is sort of just the cycle that I think about. We start the initial treatment and we continue that treatment until progression. And I'll talk about what progression means, you know, the nitty gritty of it. Or sometimes we have to change treatments if the patient is having really bad side effects. Not everybody is able to tolerate all of the different therapies. And, you know, so we continue a certain treatment either until we see signs of progression, which generally tells us that the treatment is not working, or in when a patient is having, you know, side effects that are just really impacting their quality of life in a bad way. And then when either of those two things happen, then generally we recommend changing to the next line of therapy. Next slide. So how do we know if the treatment is working? And what does working mean? We know that the treatment is working, first of all, if you feel well. That's, you know, always a very good indicator that the treatment is working. But also based on lab work and scans and clinical symptoms, working generally means that the cancer is not spreading any further. We're not seeing any new areas on the scans, and we're not seeing any new growth on the scans or substantial growth. And working also means that you're tolerating the therapy generally well and tolerating the side effects reasonably. And the way that we monitor this is with what we call staging scans with lab work. And also your clinical team is also probably asking you a lot about your clinical symptoms. Do you have any new shortness of breath? Do you have any new cough? Do you have any new, you know, pain in any areas, which is also very important because new symptoms that are persistent can be a little bit concerning for progression. Next slide. So what are staging scans? When a patient is diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer, usually the diagnosis comes from a set of scans. And so we have that as a baseline. And then based on that baseline scan, staging scans are scans that we order after you start the treatment. And the radiologist will compare your metastatic breast cancer from baseline to, you know, the next set of scans. And they will compare, you know, the metastatic breast cancer lesions that we see. Are they stable? Are they, you know, not growing? Are they shrinking? Are there any new lesions? And so these scans are performed to assess the status of your MBC. They're usually performed at regular intervals. It's different for every patient. I would say, you know, the most common interval for staging scans is about every 12 weeks or 3 months. But some people may get scans earlier. Some people who have been stable for a really long time might only get scans every 6 months or so. One thing that's important with staging scans is that we use the same imaging modality over time. And when I mean imaging modality, I mean that we're either using a CAT scan or a bone scan or a PET scan. And the reason is these are all different imaging tests, and we want to be able to compare apples to apples and not apples to oranges. So it is pretty important that we try to follow the same imaging modality over time. The most common imaging modality that we usually use to monitor metastatic breast cancer are CT scans or CAT scans. And we usually get a CT scan of the chest, abdomen, pelvis. And often we'll also follow a bone scan to see if a patient has bone metastasis. And if they do, we'll follow that pretty regularly. Bone scans are a nuclear medicine scan. And we follow them at regular intervals. For some patients, we'll follow PET CT scans if for some reason we can't see their disease very well on a CT scan. Sometimes we'll use a PET CT scan. They're not necessarily better, but sometimes in certain circumstances, they can be a little bit more helpful. PET CT scans, if you've ever had your doctor order them, you probably know this, but we have a lot of trouble with insurance getting PET CT scans covered. So we're constantly calling the insurance company and doing prior auths. But sometimes we'll do PET CT scans, but I would say the most common imaging modality is a CT scan of the chest, abdomen, pelvis, and a bone scan. MRIs can be useful in some settings. We don't usually follow MRIs routinely unless a patient has a history of brain metastasis. So when breast cancer spreads to the brain, that is best followed by an MRI of the brain. And sometimes if a patient is having painful bone lesions, An MRI actually has the best sensitivity for detecting bone metastasis and also looking very granularly at the nerve structures around those bone metastasis. So sometimes we'll use MRI if we want to look at a specific area. Next slide. We also monitor lab work. So you're probably very familiar with having, you know, your blood checked. And we normally check a variety of things. It also depends on the treatment that you're on and the side effects of those treatment. For instance, you know, if a patient is on immunotherapy, then we do have to monitor some extra things like the thyroid. But in general, for most patients, we're monitoring a complete blood count, which is a CBC. The complete blood count checks your red blood cells, which is your hemoglobin, your white blood cells, as well as your platelets. The complete blood count is mostly impacted by treatment, but sometimes can also be impacted by metastatic breast cancer if there's a lot of bone involvement or bone marrow involvement. So we're usually checking that. We also usually check a complete metabolic panel. This includes labs such as liver enzymes, creatinine, which checks your kidney, also calcium levels. And the CMP can be impacted certainly by drugs that you might be on. But also we monitor the liver, particularly the liver and the kidney with the complete metabolic panel as well. Your doctor may or may not order tumor markers. Tumor markers are a little bit controversial, but sometimes we order them. And what they are is they're blood tests that can, in some patients, indicate the status of your MBC. And some examples of those are something called the CEA, the CA15-3, or the CA27-29. Now, these markers are helpful for some patients, and they're not helpful for some patients. They do not have 100% sensitivity, nowhere near 100% sensitivity of monitoring MBC. It's more like 60 to 70%. And for some patients, they're never elevated. And so they're helpful in monitoring some patients. They're not helpful in monitoring other patients. And it's very sort of tailored and sort of up to what your treatment team, you know, has decided. But one thing I'll say about tumor markers is that we don't usually use them in isolation by themselves to make a decision, but sometimes they can be helpful in helping us understand the status of your MBC in context with the labs, with the scans, with how you feel. One other thing that I just wanted to talk about, because you might hear about it, is circulating tumor DNA. There's a lot of commercials out there with the Signatera assay and things like that. So what those assays are is essentially tumor cells do shed their DNA in the bloodstream. And sometimes we can pick up those mutations by blood and by sending an assay called, you know, a circulating tumor DNA assay. And we do send those in MBC sometimes, but we send them usually when we're looking for mutations that might make you eligible for a therapy that targets a specific mutation. Right now, we don't use them to monitor the status of MBC. They've just never been shown to be more sensitive than using scans and routine lab work. But there's definitely ongoing studies looking at that. Next slide. So what is progression? If you might hear the word progression, you might hear your doctor use the word progression. It's quite a feared word in the MBC community. And essentially, progression is when cancer becomes worse or spreads, you know, in other parts of the body. And so how do we determine that? We determine it, you know, mostly by scans, but certainly often all as well how you feel and your lab work, but usually by scans. And when I'm assessing a scan to see if a patient has progression, what I'm looking at is, are there new tumors in different areas that we didn't see before on scans? Or is there growth of an MBC lesion that's appreciable? So, you know, sometimes we'll see a lesion and it'll look 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters, maybe even 3 millimeters larger. And we say, well, it's a little bit larger, but I'm not really sure that that's progression. You know, if a patient is on a clinical trial, it actually requires at least 30% growth of the sum of lesions for us to truly call progression. But it's very, you know, physician dependent, patient dependent. But in general, if we see a new lesion, or if we see, you know, substantial growth of existing lesions, then that would be something that would be concerning that you have progression. And why progression can be so distressing and a word that we all fear is because progression usually means that the current treatment that you're on is not working well enough to control the disease. And then we start to think about whether or not you need a new treatment. Next slide. One thing that I just wanted to note is that determining progression can be simple, but it can also be complex, and there's a lot of nuances to it. Sometimes we're not sure if new areas truly represent new cancer growth or not. And so that's where you really rely on your treatment team and your doctor who has experience to understand. An example would be maybe you have a new 1 or 2 millimeter lung nodule. That wouldn't be something that would really concern me. It would be something that we'd watch over time, but I wouldn't necessarily call it progression. There might be a little bit of new uptake on a bone scan in the rib, but we don't actually see a tumor there on the CAT scan and you don't feel abnormal in that area. And, you know, we might not know whether you just hit a chair wrong, you know, and have a traumatic injury, or whether or not it's truly progression. And in cases where we're not sure and you're otherwise feeling well, oftentimes we'll just do a shorter interval scan. So we'll say, okay, well, something's a little bit different here, but it's not substantial. Instead of doing scans in 12 weeks, we're going to do scans in 8 weeks or something like that. That's always an option. There's also an entity called flare phenomenon, which is where we see a transient increase in the number of bone metastasis usually on a bone scan, sometimes on a CAT scan. And this is usually on the first or second scan after you start a new hormonal treatment or a new chemotherapy. And, you know, most physicians that treat metastatic breast cancer are aware of this phenomenon and are comfortable calling flare versus true progression. But your doctor will use labs, scans, how you feel to determine whether or not you have progression to make a decision. Next slide. So what is Scanxiety? Scanxiety is a term that a lot of my patients use and is kind of in the Facebook groups and on Twitter. And what Scanxiety is, first of all, I want to say that it's extremely common. And part of what we want to do today is identify this as a true entity and really normalize it. But Scanxiety is feelings of anxiety that come around the time of staging scans, or maybe even just a doctor's visit. And this is extremely common for patients to feel anxious, nervous before scans. So what are maybe some of the symptoms of Scanxiety that you might feel? Some really common things. My patients can't sleep, you know, the night or two before scans. They're, you know, thinking and thoughts are running through their mind about what are the scans going to show? You know, what does this mean? Maybe a racing heart, a little bit of chest heaviness, not, you know, true chest pain, but just a little bit of heaviness on the chest, feelings of dread, a little bit of shortness of breath, inability to sleep, being tearful, being more agitated, more irritable, you know, with our loved ones. Sometimes even diarrhea can happen because of the catecholamine surge that comes with anxiety. These are all common things that you might feel, you know, leading up to a scan. Next slide. And why does this happen? You know, it's because staging scans are scary. You know, staging scans are when we're looking at the status of your breast cancer to see if the treatment that you're on is working or to see if it's not working and we need to try something else. And there's a lot of natural questions that might come up in your mind when you're going to get a scan. Is the treatment working? What if it's not working? If it's not working, what will we try next? What will the side effects be? Where is the cancer in my body? And, you know, my patients try to, you know, control things by understanding where the cancer is in every, you know, single part of their body. What does this mean for my prognosis if I do have progression? All of these are normal things that are probably, could be, maybe not, but maybe running through your head at the time of a staging scan. And there's a lot of feeling of loss of control as well. And so that can be incredibly hard to manage and really distressing. Next slide.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sammons. That was incredibly helpful to learn a lot more about. Really appreciate your time and expertise. Now it is my honor to introduce each of you to Jess Mosey. She is a clinical social worker at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in the Breast Oncology Center. And she joined Dana-Farber in October of 2022, but has worked in the field of medical social work for 10 years. Thank you so much, Jess, for joining us and sharing strategies for managing Scanxiety.
Of course. Thank you for that introduction, Catherine. And Dr. Sammons, thank you for that great information. I'm so happy to spend some time with you all this afternoon. And as mentioned, we'll be discussing Scanxiety, what it is, what it looks like, and how to manage it. Next slide. So what is Scanxiety? And as Dr. Sammons had mentioned, it's really defined as an increased level of anxiousness and worry that patients feel before, during, and actually after a scan too. This anxiety is often triggered as we're monitoring treatment response to determine next steps or a need for changes. So it can cause a significant amount of fear for a lot of patients and caregivers as well. Because we don't know, there's so many unknowns and uncertainties moving forward. And as many of you have probably felt before, you know, that anxiety that comes up in between scans, whether it's every few weeks or a few months or 6 months, it can be really significant and impact us a lot. So to make this a little bit more interactive, using the chat feature, can people share what Scanxiety might look like for them? This can be any physical, emotional, or mental symptoms that you might experience. And you can just throw it in the chat and we can kind of see what people say. Well, as we know, a lot of people might feel very different things, but as Dr. Sammons had mentioned, you know, there's a lot of similarities for symptoms, which include, but aren't limited to, mood changes. So that irritability, sometimes also feeling withdrawn. We might become more isolated because we're so anxious that we can't really seek out support from others. There's a lot of the fear of recurrence, which of course for metastatic patients is very significant and profound. There's that sense of loss of control, a lot of perseverating thoughts too, which then can impact a lot of the physical symptoms that Dr. Sammons had mentioned. Thank you. Next slide, please. So with all of that being said, how do we manage this? So oftentimes it can be helpful if we anticipate that we have anxiety. So sometimes if we know that we're going to have a scan coming up and we can anticipate that we had anxiety before our last scans, or know that we have some underlying anxiety already, it can be helpful to anticipate and have the self-awareness that, you know, I know my scan's coming up in a few months, and sometimes I'll have anxiety maybe a week ahead of time or a few days before the scan. And by having that self-awareness, we can start to incorporate some coping skills ahead of time instead of waiting until it worsens moving forward. We can also try to prepare for our medical tests. So sometimes if we have a lot of questions that we have for our medical team, it can be really beneficial to just write your questions down. This is a really easy task and seems very straightforward. But believe me, sometimes like just having all your questions set in front of you can be really beneficial. And then we know that we have a lot of the answers to the degree that the team can answer. And then we can leave that scan knowing that we'll either have some answers or we know that we'll get some answers moving forward. And it's really important to be open with your concerns, with your team and your providers. We also want to acknowledge the worries. Sometimes people have anxiety that comes up and try to stuff it away or push it away, because oftentimes it can be really hard to really acknowledge those things and validate the worries and thoughts, because scans are scary. They bring up a lot and they trigger a lot. There are a lot of unknowns and uncertainties. And so it's okay to be anxious. Sometimes just having that normalization can be really helpful. So all of your worries and concerns are normal. And this goes for both patients and caregivers as well. So providing a set space can limit worries and allow ourselves conscious time to focus on them. But it also won't allow us to be overwhelmed at times. So if we set aside some time saying, you know, I'm getting really anxious about my scan that's coming up. It's in a couple of days. Maybe I'm working right now, so I don't really have time. And sometimes we all have responsibilities. So sometimes just creating space later on to acknowledge these thoughts, sometimes journaling and writing things down, or seeking out someone that you can talk to about these fears and worries and concerns that you truly trust can be really helpful just to put them out there. And though we can't always resolve these situations, at least we acknowledge them instead of stuffing them away, and because they're always going to rear their heads. So as mentioned, unfortunately, we can't control the results of scans. So sometimes just pivoting our focus on things that we can control can be helpful throughout the process. So sometimes things that we can control might look like keeping a routine. And this doesn't mean that we're just pushing away those thoughts, but keeping a routine can help us keep on track so we don't feel that chaos that the scanxiety often creates and that sense of loss of control. So we want to pivot our control on things that we can actually focus on. So keeping that routine, sometimes staying healthy, utilizing walking, and hopefully knock on wood, the weather is getting better. But utilizing walking, exercise, there's amazing videos from the Zacum Center that we can utilize. So if we do have some limitations, because sometimes with the side effects of different treatments, we're not always able to do the exercises that we maybe used to be able to do. But there are a lot of videos on the Zacum Center that can help with limitations and mobility issues, and keep in mind some of the limitations around treatments. Distractions can also be really helpful. So there's a variety of different distractions. Sometimes distractions have a bad connotation, but you know, if we use them correctly, they can be helpful. So work can be a good distraction as long as we have good boundaries around work. And if we're able to continue working. Sometimes if seeing friends or family or utilizing hobbies. Also, we have to keep in mind that sometimes, again, we have limitations as, you know, if we're going through treatment, we might not be able to go out and do all the things that we want to do. And sometimes it's helpful to kind of adjust some of these things, just as we might adjust some of the exercise that we're not able to do. Sometimes adjusting, being able to do things or see people and utilize hobbies, just as a way that we can continue to do those things. And that also helps minimize the losses that we might feel. And then mindfulness techniques can be really beneficial. Some of those things might be guided meditations, and guided meditations, sometimes meditation can be really challenging, where it tells you to just get rid of all the thoughts in your mind, and that seems impossible at times. But guided meditations can be really beneficial, where it allows you to kind of focus on certain things. And there are great resources that help the cancer patients specifically. And we have some of those on the SACEM Center website, and we can certainly provide that information to all of you. Deep breathing can be really beneficial as well. That can be really helpful, especially when our anxiety is really high. So maybe when we're waiting in the waiting room before our scan, we might have that sense of anxiety that is really high at that point. So deep breathing can really bring the anxiety down pretty quickly. Sometimes you might notice that if you have anxiety before meeting your doctor or a scan, if they take your blood pressure, it might be really high. If you do some deep breathing, you might see that it actually bring it down. And then also, you know, we can also use grounding exercises. And some of those grounding exercises might look like, you know, again, if our anxiety is really heightened, just trying to focus on maybe five things in the room that we see that are blue. You know, they can be very straightforward things. So sometimes those grounding exercises just bring the anxiety down so we can try to focus on other things. There's also the ability to seek out support from others. So if you have really good friends and family, loved ones that you can lean on for support, Dana-Farber also has some great support groups that can help manage some of this Scanxiety as well as normalize some of the things that you might be going through. We also have our social work and psychiatry department that can be really helpful as well. And lastly, awaiting results can be really difficult. So utilizing some of these coping skills after scans can be really useful. Sometimes planning something to look forward to after scans and awaiting results can be a good way to manage the scans after scan anxiety, because that result period can be really challenging because it triggers so many unknowns and uncertainties. And again, with metastatic cancer, there are a lot of things that might come up for us, a lot of questions and scary thoughts and fears about moving forward. And as Dr. Sammons mentioned, potential progression. And sometimes with these triggers come up every single time we have scans coming up. So it can be really wearing on us. So I think utilizing some of these coping skills can be really beneficial and really help kind of manage some of those things moving forward. Next slide. So now we can go into our question and answer portion.
Thank you so much, Jess. I think that was really helpful. We are getting a ton of questions in the chat, and I think most of them are more related around scanning. I've answered some of them, but I'm just going to, you know, kind of go down the list. For PET scans, is there a special diet prior to the morning of the scans? I see it on social media, but I've never heard of such a thing. Well, you know, depending on where you're getting your radiology test, there's different recommendations on dieting and how long they don't want you to eat or they do want you to eat. So I guess my first recommendation is you should talk to the radiology center where you're getting your scan. Most of the time they ask you not to eat or drink anything other than plain water for either 4 to 6 hours before the PET CT scan. Some websites that you look at will say it could be helpful to eat a low carbohydrate diet the day before the scan. You know, in metastatic breast cancer, I'm not sure that that's super important. But you know, I don't think it would be a bad thing to consider doing a low carbohydrate diet the day before the scan. Some places recommend that, some don't. I don't think it's super important. I don't think eating a low carbohydrate diet is going to change how the metastatic breast cancer looks on a PET scan. But if you wanted to do that, you could. And today we're going to answer questions that are really kind of related to staging scans, progression. So one patient writes, doesn't the goals of therapy also include maintaining a decent quality of life? And goals can change and should be addressed periodically. I would say absolutely. And I think I put that quality of life is sort of intimately related to the side effects of treatments, which can be incredibly challenging for patients to manage. And so, you know, not only are we, this is more sort of about progression, but of course, anytime we're evaluating a patient on a treatment, we're always asking them, how are they feeling? What side effects of therapy are they having? And, you know, side effects of therapy can be incredibly challenging to manage. And I think it is always really important to think about what your goals are. So in terms of quality of life related goals, and Jess, I don't know, do you ever talk to patients about quality of life related goals? And how do you sort of approach those conversations?
Yeah, so quality of life is so important for a lot of patients. And as social workers, we address it all the time with people. You know, how you're living day to day so impacts your mental, physical, and emotional health. So as social workers, we try to provide support to patients around what quality of life looks like, how we might be able to adjust what that quality of life looks like for patients. So if there are losses that people aren't able to manage anymore, how we might be able to adjust those so we continue to have a good quality of life. Because again, you know, that can certainly impact just how we manage our day-to-day lives. And we, just because we have cancer doesn't mean that we want to have it define us either. We want to be able, to the extent that we can, to continue to do the things we enjoy doing as much as possible.
And I would just say that you should bring it up with your treatment team. I mean, when your treatment team is talking to you about a next line of therapy, that's a great time for you to say, you know what? The side effects of this treatment are extremely important to me. I want to think about therapies that, you know, have a favorable side effect profile. I had a patient yesterday who, you know, is running out of endocrine therapy options, and IV chemotherapy is really, you know, the next line of therapy, and she's really worried about that. And so we talked about some different IV chemotherapies that, you know, have a more favorable side effect profile. Maybe we'll try some of them first before we try some of the newer antibody drug conjugates that have, you know, a little bit more side effects. And so really just important for you to talk to your treatment team about your goals, you know, and how important quality of life is to you. It's incredibly important to some people to have minimal side effects of therapy, and it's not important to other people. Some people say, give me the therapy that has the best efficacy and the chance of working for my cancer. And that's a very personal thing for everyone that you should communicate with your team.
Exactly.
Another question here is that given that about 50% of patients with triple negative or HER2 positive breast cancer will develop brain metastasis, that's when cancer spreads to the brain, why aren't we doing those scans routinely? I'll say 50% is probably, you know, it's probably more like a third for triple negative breast cancer will develop brain metastasis. And depending on the study, you look at a third to 50% of patients with HER2 positive disease will develop brain metastasis. And, you know, this patient is right. Right now, our national guidelines do not say that we need to be doing screening MRIs for all patients with metastatic breast cancer. And, you know, we there are clinical trials going on. We have a clinical trial at Dana-Farber right now looking to see if, particularly in either triple negative breast cancer, HER2 positive breast cancer, or HR positive HER2 negative breast cancer after a few lines of therapy, if screening the brain improves outcomes. So, because that's the important question, maybe we will identify, you know, smaller brain lesions, But will that lead to improved outcomes if we have to then intervene on them and do radiation sooner, which also has side effects? And so I think it's a complex topic, but a good point. And we are definitely investigating that. But I would say that it's important to tell your doctor if you're having any neurologic symptoms, headaches, vision changes, memory changes, weakness, because then they would definitely want to order an MRI. Let's see. Couple more questions about this sort of flare entity. So I talked a little bit about how, and it's usually on the first either bone scan or PET scan after you start, and it's usually an endocrine-based therapy, sometimes a chemotherapy. Sometimes we can see this flare phenomenon. And what is that? So on a bone scan, sometimes we'll see a few new bone lesions, but on the CAT scan, there's usually no progression, and the lesions actually look more sclerotic. And in that case, that tells us that this is probably more of flare than true progression. And I think it just takes an experienced oncologist to sort of know the difference. We can see flare in a PET CT. So we can see the FDG avidity, which is how bright something is on the scan, be a little bit brighter on the first scan after starting treatment. But if we see that, we're also not really going to be seeing, you know, if they have flare on the PET, if they have any visceral disease or lymph nodes or lung or liver lesions, you'll probably see a response there. And it would just be the bone lesions that were flaring a little bit. And it would just probably be the first or second scan. And so it's a really nuanced sort of entity that I think you would just have to talk to, you know, an experienced breast oncologist about. Let's see. Can you see bone metastasis on CST scans or bone scans? The answer is yes. We can see bone metastasis on CAT scans and bone scans. The sensitivity of detecting bone metastasis, though, is different for every different imaging modality. So for a CAT scan and bone scan, it might be around 70%. And it also depends on if you have osteolytic or osteoblastic bone metastasis, which are different types of bone metastasis. And that sort of helps us know which scan might better detect them. PET CTs are pretty highly sensitive for bone metastasis as well, and MRIs are the most sensitive, but we of course can't just MRI the whole body every couple of months, but MRIs are extremely sensitive. So if I have a patient that's having a lot of pain in one area and we do a CAT scan or a bone scan and we don't see anything, but they're still having pain, I will usually order a follow-up MRI just because that is the most sensitive test. Let's see.
Dr. Sammons, we did.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, we did. I just wanted to make a note. We had someone just provide some good suggestions and kind of normalizing some of the suggestions we had made, just saying as a patient who's been dealing with this disease for a long time, she's come to acceptance and she's become very acquainted with a lot of people with MBC and has a support group that she finds very helpful, along with a palliative care doctor. So it's just nice to see some of the suggestions that other people provide too, and find helpful.
So, I think that's really, you know, helping understand how people manage an MBC diagnosis and scans is always helpful. And I liked one of the things that you said where you talked about, you know, we should focus on the things that we can control. And we should try to focus a little less on the things that we can't control. Mm-hmm. We can't control what a scan is going to show. We can control who our doctor is. We can control that we take our medication. We can control our communication. Well, hopefully you can control somewhat your communication with the medical team and how your side effects and, you know, what you're eating and how active you are. You can control if you're seeing a social worker for your mental health, control exercise and diet. So focusing on things that you can control and less on the ones that you can't, I think has been very helpful for my patients. Let's see, a lot of really medical, a lot of really medical based questions here. I'm not really going to comment on sort of individual cases. So let me just find some that might be more generalizable to the crowd. How long do you typically try a new therapy before determining whether or not it's working? That's a really good question. I think, you know, on average, I would say we want to give it a couple of months to see if it's working. And so we'll do scans about 12 weeks after starting treatment. We think that that's usually a pretty good amount of time. Now, with that being said, if a patient is on a clinical trial, which is a more investigational agent, we're not really sure, you know, if it's going to work or not. Sometimes those trials do scans sooner. Sometimes they'll do scans at like the 6 or 8 week mark. So it's highly variable, but I would say on average, we want to give the treatment a couple of months to work. Certainly 2-3 weeks is not enough time to know if a treatment is working. So we usually give it a couple of months. 3 months is a good average to see if a treatment is working. Of course, if you're having symptoms of worsening cancer burden, you know, before the 3 month mark, you should let your team know. And sometimes, you know, we'll move up those scans. But a couple of months is usually good. Can MBC go anywhere in the body? Can it go to any organ? That's a really good question as well. I think the most common places for metastatic breast cancer to spread are the liver, the lung, the lymph nodes, and the bones. And then, you know, sometimes the brain. So for hormone receptor positive breast cancer, only about 10 to 12% of patients will ever develop brain metastasis, whereas triple negative, it's more like a third. HER2 positive, it's more like a third to a half. You know, MBC can, you know, it doesn't usually go to the bones of the foot or the fingers, but it can go to any bone. It can go to the brain. It doesn't usually go to the kidneys. You know, there's caveats to everything. Lobular breast cancer, which there's some questions in the chat about, is breast cancer that starts from the lobules in the breast and not the duct. Lobular breast cancer has a different sort of spreading pattern. Lobular breast cancer does often spread to the bones or other organs. But lobular breast cancer, because it lacks a certain protein that forms, you know, really specific tumors, it's sort of highly infiltrative. So we can see it in the abdominal lining. We can see it along the kidneys. We can see it in the colon or the GI tract. And so lobular breast cancer can have a different spreading entity. But most common things being common, liver, lung, bones, lymph nodes. But there's always, you know, caveats and breast cancer can spread to other places. Let's see. We'll probably take just a few more questions. My team recommended an FES PET scan to check on a bone lesion that showed up on a CT scan and not a PET scan. Can you speak about this newer tool? There's a couple of questions about FES PET scans, so I'll just address them. FES PET scans are, PET scans in general are CAT scans, but there's a separate dye that, or there's a separate basically dye that is given to you by an IV that goes in your bloodstream. So the most common PET is called an FDG PET. And the dye in that type of PET scan goes to cells that are metabolically active, because the FDG is kind of like a glucose dye. And so you can imagine that cancer cells that are proliferating faster are going to need more glucose. And so that glucose dye is going to go to areas of active malignancy. Now, an FES PET is totally different. That dye is not glucose-based. An FES PET has estradiol, which is actually estrogen, as the dye. So that estrogen goes into your body and it binds to estrogen receptors. And so FES PET is being studied to look at, it's being studied in a few different ways. It's very new, but it's being studied to look at, can FES PET detect estrogen positive breast cancers better? Can FES PET be utilized to tell us if a patient's cancer might respond better to endocrine-based strategies? We can't use FES PET yet to give us information about whether or not you might respond to a different therapy, but there are clinical trials going on looking at that. Whether or not FES PET is better than PET scan for hormone receptor positive breast cancer, there are some small trials that say that if you truly have estrogen positive disease, FES PET might detect more lesions. And so it is, you know, a lot of centers are having it. I will say at Dana-Farber, we use FES PET to, you know, see if a tumor might be estrogen positive. If for some reason we can't get a biopsy, that's sometimes that we might use it to see, you know, if it's lighting up, then we know that there's estrogen on those cells. And, you know, if we can't get a biopsy, then that's useful for us to know that we might be able to target estrogen. But we're not using it routinely yet, at least, to, you know, diagnose metastatic disease in all estrogen positive patients. I think it's still an up and coming tool, but I think it's very promising. One of the other things about FES PET is it doesn't work after you get a lot of estrogen blocking therapies. And so you can't have an FES PET after you've had fulvestrant for a couple of months, any type of oral SERD, at least a week after an aromatase inhibitor. So there are some caveats there that, you know, monitoring FES PET for treatment efficacy is probably not going to be helpful in patients that are on endocrine therapy, but we're still learning a lot about it. All right. Well, I'm going to take one more question, and I will try to answer some of them in the chat, but there are over 40, so we're just not going to be able to address them all. Let's see if we can take one that is more generalizable to the group. Oh, here's a good one. How can we handle sleeplessness? So if a patient is, you know, having anxiety, maybe they're not having anxiety, but they're having trouble sleeping, you know, just because of the treatment that they're on. How do you talk to patients about how to monitor sleeplessness or treat it, Jess?
So oftentimes, like, a lot of things that can be helpful, and a lot of patients, because of the side effects of meds, like you said, really create some of that restlessness for people, especially some of the steroids and things like that. So sometimes utilizing like a routine before bed can be helpful, just making sure that we go to bed at the same time each night to a degree. I mean, things come up, life happens. So sometimes that can be helpful. Also, to incorporate with that routine, maybe utilizing like meditation, or sometimes even journaling can be really helpful, because it just allows people to get a lot of those thoughts that might be racing in their minds because of that, that's causing some of that anxiety before bed. So that can always impact the ability to sleep. So sometimes journaling before bed can be helpful. Just trying to trying to decompress from the day, utilizing deep breathing and mindfulness techniques are really helpful. A lot of my patients utilize those things a couple of people in the chat, or someone in the chat mentioned being able to do yoga and things like that. So, and yoga is a great way to incorporate both the exercise aspect and the meditation aspect. And so all of those things, I think it shows a variety of different ways that we can utilize to get some of these perseverating thoughts off of our mind and kind of just place them somewhere else. So we're not, it doesn't impact our sleep the whole time. And then we're not able to sleep. Of course, with, you know, if coping skills and maybe talking to a social worker, all of these things, like utilizing different supports, might be helping, but not to the degree that we were hoping. There's also other medications, which I know, like, sometimes we want to avoid adding something else. But we do have a psychiatry department too, that might be able to help with things too. So I think there's a variety of different ways to address certain things too.
Thank you so much, Jess.
Of course.
Thank you both so much for sharing your time and expertise this afternoon. This has been so helpful.